Okay. So these are some common names which you have to know. Common names are not IUPAC names, they are different. You have to know some common names. Sometimes in the exam directly common name is given. So if you don't know the common name, you won't be able to identify the compound. So I have given a list of common names which will be required for 11th as well as 12th standard topics. You can refer to this list later. You need not learn all the common names now. So just go through them, and before the end of your 12th standard, you should be able to learn all the common names. So as of now, you need not hurry. I have given this list so that later you can refer to this list and you can learn the common names so that you know which common names are there for our syllabus. So right now you need not worry about this. Keep this with you safely so that later you can go through this and then learn. Okay, so there is something which is pending, which will finish. These are the common names, and you can do these common names later. You will see some common names have star marks. So I have put star marks against some common names. So you can see there are some star marks. Star marks mean that they are very important and focus on them first. So when you are learning the common names, first finish the common names of these compounds which have star marks against them. Okay. So finish those which have star marks against them. Okay. Now I'll tell you one particular part about common names of aromatic compounds, that is this particular thing. If I have something attached, let's say this is my benzene ring, and to the ring I have something attached. Let's say I have this X. X could be anything. It is some group which is attached. Now, this position, that is the position which is immediately next to the position of X, this particular carbon atom where I have put an arrow, this particular carbon atom is immediately adjacent. Even this one is immediately adjacent. So these are called ortho positions. O stands for ortho, small o. And these positions are meta positions. Small m stands for meta. And the position which is diametrically opposite, that is this position, is called para. P stands for para. So in common names, you will come across O, M and P for aromatic compounds. That is what I've told you. So O means ortho, M means meta, P means para. If two adjacent carbon atoms have groups attached, then we call both of them ortho. If I have something attached to a carbon which is alternate, that means which is one after the initial carbon, then we call it meta position. And the position which is exactly opposite is called para position. So this is one thing that you have to know for common names: ortho, meta and para. Now, let's go ahead with the last part. So you can note down the common names later when you have time. You need not note down now. What we need to do now is a bit different. A few things are pending. We'll finish those. First thing is that this. Now, some substituents have multiple names, which you have to know. That is why I've given this list. So these substituents are known by multiple names. So a particular substituent may be called by two different names or three different names. So you should know those three names for the substituent. For example, if you look at the first one here, the first one is called ethinine and also it is called vinyl. So there are two names for the first substituent. So when you see CH2 double bond CH as a substituent, you can either call it ethinine or you can call it vinyl. Similarly, if you look at the second one, you can either call this prop2-inyl or you can call it propargyl. So alternative names. That means this same substituent has two different names. You must be aware of the multiple names for the same substituent. Look at the third one. So the third one also has different names. It could be called this or this. Also, it could be called this. So if you come across any of these in questions, then you should be able to identify the substituent. That is why you should know the different names for the same substituent. Similarly, if we look at the next one, fourth one. Again, the fourth one has two different names. The fifth one also has names, sixth and seventh. So these are some substituents which have multiple names. Now, another important substituent comes here, which you see as a note. If you have this substituent, that is OC double bond OCH3, this entire thing, if you have as a substituent, it is called acetoxy. So if this entire thing appears as a substituent in any compound, you should know how to name it. is called acetoxin. Let's do one example where we have used this, then you will understand. So if I talk about one example here, for example, let's look at this particular compound. Now in this compound, you have COOH present, and also you have OCOCH3 present. So COOH and OCOCH3. These are the two different groups that you see in this compound. Now, out of these two, the priority goes to this, because we have learned the priority series. And in the priority series, if you see, carboxylic acid has the highest priority. Since COOH gets the priority here, I will put number 1 here and 2 here. So I'm numbering the ring. For numbering the ring, I'll put 1 on that carbon which has the priority. So the priority here is COOH. And hence I've put 1 on that carbon where COOH is attached. So the carbon where OCOCH3 is attached becomes carbon number 2. Okay, now we know that if one group is getting the priority, then we must use its corresponding suffix. Since COOH has been given the priority here, we have to use the suffix corresponding to that. And immediately, whatever else is present will become a substituent. And for substituent, we use prefix. So this entire thing has become our substituent, that is OCOCH3. So this entire thing has become the substituent. Since this has become the substituent, I'll have to use the prefix for this. The prefix for OCOCH3 is, just now we learned it. It is what? It is acetoxin. Right? So when OCOCH3 is present as a substituent, it is called acetoxin. So we will say that this is acetoxin. And hence the name will be this. 2-acetyloxy or 2-acetoxy benzoic acid. So benzoic acid is the suffix because COOH is attached directly to the benzene ring. So benzoic acid will be the suffix. And acetyloxy or acetoxy is going to be the prefix for OCOCH3 because that's a substituent. So the name is 2. Why 2? Because at the second position I have the substituent. So 2-acetyloxybenzoic acid. This compound is very important because it is used as a medicine. And its common name is aspirin. Right? Aspirin. So it's a medicine. So its common name is aspirin. So if they ask you what is aspirin, you should be able to draw the structure of aspirin. So this is aspirin. And if they ask you what is the IUPAC name of aspirin, then you should be able to say that the IUPAC name of aspirin is 2-acetyloxybenzoic acid. question. Okay, now let's come to this part. IUPAC C, nomenclature of acid and hydrides. So we have not learned nomenclature of acid and hydrides thus far. So now we will do that. First of all, let's understand the meaning of an acid or hydride. So an acid and hydride has this particular type of structure. That is C, double bond O, then again O in between, and then again C, and then double bond O. Such is the structure of an acid and hydride. So an acid and hydride has this particular structure. This, definitely this entity will be present inside an acid and hydride. So C double bond O, and then you have one oxygen atom in between, and then again C double bond O. This is called an acid and hydride. How to name an acid and hydride? Let's see that. So it is very simple. You will look at only one part at a time. So either you will look at the right hand side of oxygen, or you will look at the part which is attached to the left hand side of oxygen. So if I'm focusing on the right hand side, that time I will not look at the left hand side. And when I'm looking at the left hand side, I will not look at the right hand side. So let's see now. The method is to number the anhydride in this way. That is, you place carbon 1, that is, you place number 1 on this carbon, which is directly connected to oxygen atom. This carbon will be numbered 1. And then the normal way of numbering you can do. So if you look at this first example, here I have written 1. So I'm focusing only on this part for the moment. So 1, 2, 3, 4. I have numbered. So 1, 2, 3, 4. I have numbered only the portion which is on the right hand side of the oxygen atom. So if I look at this, at the third position I have a bromine attached. So 3 bromo. So you see this part, 3 bromo. 3 bromo butanoic. Why butanoic? Because there are 4 carbon atoms in the chain that I have selected now. So 3 bromo butanoic. And then I will now focus on the part which is present on the other side. So now I will focus on this portion. Again, I will place number 1 on this carbon, which is directly connected to oxygen. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, I will number the carbon atoms. Now here if I see OH is attached at the third carbon. So 3-hydroxy, because hydroxy is going to be the prefix for OH, because the priority has been given to acid and hydride. So 3-hydroxy, pentanoic, because there are 5 carbon atoms in this part. So 3-hydroxy pentanoic. And then at the end, I have to write the word anhydride. So this is a complete name. 3-bromobutanoic, 3-hydroxy pentanoic, anhydride. Try to name this one. As you can see, I've already put the numbers. So now you can try to name the second compound.
How will we know which to put it first, butanoic or pentanoic?
Alphabetical order. Like here, if you see, B comes before H. That is why I have written first 3-bromobutanoic.
Okay, sir.
So at the end, when you write the name, take care of the alphabetical order while writing. So just like here, if you see it is B, and here we have H. So B and H have been compared. So if I start, then let's look at this part. So here 1, 2, 3, 4. So bute 4, so I'll have to use the word bute. So bute 2 in oic. Right, because there's a double bond between second and third carbon atoms. So bute 2 in oic. Bute 2 in oic. Now let's come to the other side of oxygen. So here 1, 2, 3. So now this portion has to be dealt with. So this portion now has 3 carbon atoms in the main chain. So 1, 2, and 3. 3 carbon atoms are there in the main chain. And I can say CHO is a substituent which is attached to the second carbon. And PH is the benzene ring which is attached to the third carbon. So PH is what? The benzene ring which is attached. That is called phenyne because it's a substituent here. CHO as a substituent is called formyl. So this is the name. 2-formyl, that is for CHO. This formyl is for CHO. 3-phenyl, that is for PH. The third carbon has phenyl. And then propanoic. Propanoic because there are 3 carbon atoms in the main chain. 1, 2, 3. The ones that have been numbered. And then the end has to be anhydride. Because the principal functional group here is anhydride. Note down the example. Next part, nomenclature of epoxides. What is an epoxide? So if you see a cyclic ether, that means you have oxygen and then you will have a ring type structure. So oxygen is going to be a part of the ring. Such a thing is called epoxide. So if I look at the first example, this is an epoxide. So if I name the epoxide, again I select the longest chain of carbon atoms. So here I have selected 1, 2, 3. So since there are 3 carbon atoms, I have written propane. These numbers indicate the positions of the carbon atoms which have the oxygen atom between. So the oxygen atom is present between 1 and 2. It is connected to both 1 as well as 2. Hence I have written 1, 2. The word epoxy also will come because this is an epoxide. So 1, 2 epoxy propane. This is going to be the IUPAC name. let's try the next one. This is the second example. So again, I will select the longest chain. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 carbon atoms are present in the chain that I have selected. The second carbon atom has this as a substituent, that is CH3 is attached as a substituent. And also the second carbon atom has this oxygen atom. So now the oxygen atom is present between 2 and 3. So 2, 3 epoxy. 2, 3 epoxy. So 2 and 3 indicate the number, I mean the positions of those two carbon atoms which have the oxygen atom between. So 2, 3 epoxy. And then 2-methyl, because the second carbon atom also has a methyl attached. So 2, 3 epoxy, 2-methyl, and then butane, because there are 4 carbon atoms in the chain selected. Next one. Again, I have to select the longest chain of carbon atoms. Now there are 9 carbon atoms in the longest chain. So again, the oxygen atom is connected to 2 and 3. So I'll have to say 2, 3 epoxy. And the first carbon atom has a chlorine attached. So 1-chloro. So 1-chloro, 2, 3 epoxy. 7 has a methyl attached. Which one is that? This one, which you see the line which is coming out of the 7th carbon. This is nothing but a methyl attached, right? So this is the subsequent methyl attached to the 7th carbon. So 7-methyl. Nonane, because there are 9 carbon atoms in the parent chain, so nonane. Now, if I number this compound in the other way, that is from the other end, if this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Then, why is this wrong? If I numbered in this way, then why is this wrong? This is wrong because if I look at the positions containing the substituents, then they will be 3, 3, why 3? Because now the third carbon has this as a subsequent. So 3, comma, 7. Because the 7th carbon atom has the oxygen attached. 8, the 8th carbon atom also has the oxygen attached. And then 9, because the 9th carbon atom has a chlorine attached. This will be the positions of the carbon atoms containing the substituents. And in this case, the positions were 1, 2, 3, and 7. If I compare this and this, this is correct and this is wrong. Why? Because when I compare 1 by 1, so I'll compare the first locant of this set and the first locant of this set. 1 and 3 will be compared. If I compare 1 and 3, 1 is lower than 3. And so this is correct as per the first point of difference rule. And this is wrong. Hence, this is the correct name that is written here. So this is the correct way of numbering. Next one. Again, I have an epoxide. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, if you look at the oxygen atom, it is connected to carbon number 1 and carbon number 4. Hence, I have written 1, 4, epoxy. So carbon 1 and carbon 4 have the oxygen atom which are attached. So the carbon 1 and carbon 4 are the two carbon atoms which have the oxygen atom attached to them. So 1, 4 epoxy represents that portion. And then butane, because there are four carbon atoms that have been numbered. So butane. Fifth one. So I may number it in this way. 1, 2, 3, 4. So the name will be 1-bromo, 1-4 epoxy butane, 1-4. If I number it in the other way, then the name is going to be 4-bromo, 1-4 epoxy butane. So 1 and 4, if I compare, 1 is lower. Hence, this is the correct name and this is wrong. So I cannot number it in this way. This is a wrong way of numbering. It has to be this. Okay, one thing you have to understand, that is whenever we're using the words for substituents, these words iso, neo, and cyclo, these words are considered by deciding the alphabetical order. So when you talk about the alphabetical order, you will include I, N, C. So I, N, and C will be taken into consideration when you are discussing or when you are trying to analyze the alphabetical order of the substituents. But the words sec and tert, these are not considered while deciding the alphabetical order. Sec and tert, they are not considered. So this S and this T will not be taken into account when you are talking about the alphabetical order of substituents. Okay. Any doubt? Alright, so this was it for IOP's nomenclature. We'll start with the next chapter. This is the next chapter. Now, so the next chapter is thermodynamics. This is the next chapter. So we will first understand certain terms which are used in this chapter. And once we know the terms, then we can go ahead with the formulae and the mathematical calculations. First thing is this system. So system is that portion or that part which we study. That means anything which is being studied by us is called the system. So system is a portion, it's a small portion, just a small part that we have chosen. So we have chosen that particular portion in order to study its properties and whatever things we are studying with respect to that. So a small part which we have chosen is called system. Now, whatever is outside the system is called surroundings. So if I have, for example, a beaker and that beaker contains water, and if I want to study the water present inside the beaker, if I want to study its properties and if I want to study what is happening when I'm heating it, then I will say that the beaker containing the water is my system. So I've defined my system. So the system has to be defined first. So the water which is present inside the beaker is my system. Then what is surroundings? Whatever is lying outside that beaker will be a part of the surroundings. So anything and everything except the system is a part of the surroundings. So first term is system, second term is surroundings. You can start writing. So just finish writing this part, system and surroundings. Okay, the next term is boundary. So boundary is anything which separates the system from the surroundings. So it's just a separation. Like I told you, if I have a beaker containing water, if this is a beaker containing water, then this is the boundary. So this can act as a boundary. This particular thing can act as a boundary. So the wall of the beaker can act as a boundary. Why? Because it is separating this water from the surroundings. This is surroundings, right? So if I have a separation, that separation is called the surroundings. So the boundary separates the system from the rest of the universe. That means it separates the system and the surroundings. Then universe. Universe is a combination of the system and surroundings. That means it is the entire thing. System is also a part of universe. Surroundings are also a part of the universe. So the universe comprises of each and everything. So system plus surroundings is equal to universe. Write down. Okay. Next. The modes of energy transfer. So how can energy be transferred? There are two ways in which energy can be transferred. So if there's a change in energy, how is that change of energy happening? There are two different ways of energy transfer. The first one is called heat, and the second one is called work. Let's understand the difference between heat and work now. Start writing, then I'll explain. Okay, now what is heat? Heat is a form of energy. That's the first thing. And it is that form of energy which arises due to difference in temperatures. So there are two different temperatures. One is a high temperature, one is a low temperature, because there are two different values of temperatures. So the flow of energy that takes place because the two bodies are at two different temperatures is called heat. So if I ask you what is the definition of heat, you will say that heat is that form of energy which arises due to a difference in temperatures. For example, if I say that I have a beaker and that beaker contains some hot water. Okay, there is some hot water inside the beaker. If I keep this beaker containing hot water just like that, without covering its surface, if I just keep it, then what will happen? It is open to the atmosphere. After some time, the water will become cool, or it will become much colder than what it was before. That means gradually the temperature of that water will decrease. That means there has been a flow of energy, and that flow of energy has taken place outside. Why outside? Because this was hot, this liquid, that is water inside the beaker, was very hot. The ambient temperature was lower than the temperature of hot water. So heat flowed out of the hot water to the atmosphere, and as a result, the temperature of the water came down. So this difference in temperatures caused flow of heat out of the beaker. So I can say that heat is flow of energy due to a difference in temperature. Now the next form of energy exchange, that is work. What is work? So work is that flow of energy that does not arise due to difference in temperatures. ऐसा नहीं कि because temperatures are different इसके लिए work हो रहा है. ऐसा नहीं है. Temperature का difference नहीं है, लेकिन work फिर भी हो रहा है. So if I ask you to define work, you will say that work is that form of energy which arises due to something, but not because of difference in temperatures. For example, work can be electrical work, it can be mechanical work, right? It can be work done in case of expansion of a gas. It could be work done because of compression of a gas. So work is also a form of energy, but it is the flow of energy which is not arising because of difference in temperatures. Difference in temperatures की वजह से जो एनर्जी फ्लो इन या आउट होती है, दैट इज कॉल्ड हीट. वर्क इज दैट फॉर्म ऑफ एनर्जी एक्सचेंज और द फ्लो ऑफ एनर्जी दैट अकर्स नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ डिफरेंस इन टेम्परेचर्स. Examples of work are electrical work, mechanical work, work done in case of expansion of gas, work done in case of compression of a gas. Various types of work are possible. So write down this heat and work. Okay, the next term is process. Now, what is a process? If my system undergoes any kind of change it could be, then I say that a process has taken place. So if there is a change in pressure in my system, then also I will say that a process has happened. If there's a change in temperature, then also I will say that some process has happened. If there's a change in volume, then also I will say that a process has taken place. Any change that occurs in my system is called a process. So I can say that the system goes from one state to another state by changing some parameter. Then I can say that a process has taken place. It could be any kind of change. It could be a change in temperature, it could be a change in pressure, it could be a change in volume. Next, we deal with the variables. Thermodynamic variables. What are thermodynamic variables? Thermodynamic variables.
Sir, can you scroll down?
So, what are thermodynamic variables? Now, thermodynamic variables define the state of a system. How do I see that my system is in a particular state? I have to specify certain parameters and then I can define that state of my system. So if I say that currently my system is at state A. So what do I mean by saying? What do I mean when I say that the system is in state A? That state A will tell me that the system has some value of pressure, it has some value of volume, it has some value of temperature, it has some value of energy inside it. So these are different variables which are used to talk about the state of our system. So whatever variables are used to define the state of a system are called thermodynamic variables. So if the system has undergone a process wherein any kind of variable has undergone a change, then I can say that yes, a process has happened because there has been a change in some variable. So the value of the variable has changed, and that is why I say that the state of the system has changed. So state of a system is characterized by certain variables, and these variables are called thermodynamic variables. The next term is cyclic process. Now see, if my system starts from a state A, it undergoes some process and it reaches state B. Then it undergoes some process and it reaches state C. And then it comes back to state A again. If such a thing happens, that is, the system starts from one point and it comes back to the same state, then we say that this is a closed cycle because it consists of a series of processes. So there's a sequence. One after the other, there are processes which happen. And ultimately the system comes back or returns to its initial state. So if the system is coming back to its initial state, we call such a cycle a closed cycle. That means in a closed cycle, the initial state is same as the final state. So ultimately, after all the processes, the system is back to its initial state. Then we call it a closed cycle. Write down. Okay, now if I talk about a particular sequence, let's say my system starts from here, then it goes like this, then it goes like this, then it comes like this, then it goes like this, and then it comes back to the initial state. So this is also an example of a closed cycle, because it consists of a series of processes happening one after the other, and ultimately the system comes back to its initial state. So this is also a closed cycle. Now remember that if I have a closed cycle, the work done in a closed cycle is not zero. Often this is asked in the exam. So work done in a closed cycle is not equal to zero. Please keep this in mind. The second statement, that is this one, this we will understand later, not now. Okay. Okay. Next important term, thermal equilibrium. What is thermal equilibrium? So when there is no change in temperature with time, so let's say the temperature remains constant after some time, then I can say that the system has achieved thermal equilibrium. That means there is no change in temperature with time. So after 25 minutes, if I measure the temperature, it is one value, let's say. One particular value I get if I measure the temperature after 25 minutes. Then again after 5 minutes, if I measure the temperature, it will be the same value. Again after 20 minutes, if I measure the temperature of the system, I'm getting the same value, which means that there is no change in temperature of the system with time. Such a case is called thermal equilibrium. Write down. Okay. Next up is mechanical equilibrium. Mechanical equilibrium means when there is no change in pressure with time. So the pressure of the system will remain constant. When there is no change in pressure with time, the system is said to be in mechanical equilibrium. Just two MCQs based on these definitions. The chemical equilibrium. When there is no change in concentrations of reactants as well as products with time, then the system is said to be in chemical equilibrium. मतलब क्या हुआ? कोई भी reaction अगर है, reaction का होते होते मानो कुछ time लगता है, कि हाँ 10 मिनट, 15 मिनट. After some time, 15 मिनट के बाद हो सकता है ऐसा कि और कोई भी चेंज हमें ना दिखे, यानी अगर हम लोग मेजर करेंगे कॉन्सेंट्रेशंस ऑफ रिएक्टेंट्स एंड प्रोडक्ट्स, तो कॉन्सेंट्रेशंस ऑफ रिएक्टेंट्स एंड प्रोडक्ट्स जो हम लोग मेजर करेंगे तो हमें दिखेगा कि और कोई चेंज कॉन्सेंट्रेशंस में नहीं हो रहा है. फिर से 5-10 मिनट के बाद वापस मैंने मेजर किया रिएक्टेंट के कॉन्सेंट्रेशंस को भी, प्रोडक्ट के कॉन्सेंट्रेशंस को भी, तो फिर मैंने ये देखा कि कोई भी चेंज कॉन्सेंट्रेशन में नहीं है. तो मतलब वो रिएक्शन अभी केमिकल इक्विलिब्रियम अचीव कर चुका है, जहां पे कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ एवरी स्पीशीज रिमेन्स फिक्स्ड. मतलब और कोई चेंज नहीं है कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ रिएक्टेंट में भी नहीं है, कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ प्रोडक्ट में भी नहीं है. तो उस सिस्टम को हम लोग बोलेंगे कि अभी वो केमिकल इक्विलिब्रियम में है. वो केमिकल इक्विलिब्रियम को अचीव करने के लिए कितना टाइम लगता है वो हम लोग बता नहीं सकते, वो तो अलग बात है. लेकिन कुछ टाइम के बाद ऐसा अगर मेजर करेंगे तो हम लोग ये देखेंगे कि और कोई कॉन्सेंट्रेशन में चेंज नहीं है. जितने रिएक्टर से सबके कॉन्सेंट्रेशन अभी एक फिक्स्ड वैल्यू आ गया, मतलब कॉन्स्टेंट हो गए, और प्रोडक्ट्स के भी कॉन्सेंट्रेशन अभी कॉन्स्टेंट हो गए. सो इफ आई हैव अ रिएक्शन लाइक दिस, तो इस रिएक्शन को मैंने चालू कर दिया. चालू करने के कुछ टाइम बाद मैंने मेजर किया कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ ए, कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ बी, कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ सी, कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ डी. मेजर करने के बाद ये देखा कि कुछ वैल्यूज मिले मुझे. फिर से 5 मिनट बाद फिर से मैंने मेजर किया तो कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ ए देखा, तो देखा कि जो यहाँ पे पहले था अभी भी वहीं पे सेम कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ए का अभी भी है. सिमिलरली बी का कॉन्सेंट्रेशन जो पहले था अभी भी उतना ही है. सो कॉन्सेंट्रेशन हैव नॉट चेंज्ड विद टाइम. सेम गोस फॉर सी एंड सेम गोस फॉर डी ऑल्सो. तो ये जो टाइम के बाद मैंने देखा, टाइम का कुछ टाइम के बाद जो मेजर किया तो भी कॉन्सेंट्रेशन में कोई फर्क नहीं आया. मतलब टाइम के साथ साथ कॉन्सेंट्रेशन में कोई फर्क नहीं आ रहा है. फिर से कंफर्म होने के लिए वापस 15 मिनट के बाद मैंने यहाँ पे वापस कॉन्सेंट्रेशन मेजर किए, फिर देखा कि अभी भी वही है जो पहले देखा था. That means now I can be certain of the fact that yes, there is no further change in concentrations with time. मतलब वो reaction अभी equilibrium achieve कर चुका है. तो हर reactant का concentration fixed एक value तक आके रुक जाएगा, उसके बाद वो change नहीं होने वाला है. Similarly, हर product का भी concentration आके रुक जाएगा, उस वैल्यू के बाद वो फर्दर चेंज हमको नहीं दिख रहा है, तो हम लोग बोलेंगे दैट द रिएक्शन हैज अचीव्ड केमिकल इक्विलिब्रियम. व्हाट इज कॉन्सेंट्रेशन? ये जो बार बार मैं कॉन्सेंट्रेशन बोल रहा हूँ उसका मतलब क्या है? इसका मतलब है मोल्स अपॉन लीटर्स, मतलब मोल्स ऑफ द स्पीशीज अपॉन टोटल वॉल्यूम ऑफ द सिस्टम. सो मोल्स अपॉन लीटर्स, उसको कॉन्सेंट्रेशन बोलते हैं. नेक्स्ट थर्मोडायनामिक इक्विलिब्रियम. अभी तक हम लोग कर रहे थे तीन टर्म्स, केमिकल इक्विलिब्रियम, मैकेनिकल इक्विलिब्रियम एंड थर्मल इक्विलिब्रियम. जब तीनों इक्विलिब्रियम एक साथ अचीव हो जाए तो उसको बोलते हैं थर्मोडायनामिक इक्विलिब्रियम. सो व्हेन अ सिस्टम इज इन थर्मल, मैकेनिकल एज वेल एज केमिकल इक्विलिब्रिया, देन द सिस्टम इज सेड टू बी थर्मोडायनामिक इक्विलिब्रियम. मतलब क्या? ना ही सिस्टम का टेम्परेचर चेंज होगा, ना ही सिस्टम का प्रेशर चेंज होगा, और ना ही सिस्टम का कॉन्सेंट्रेशन चेंज होगा किसी भी स्पीशीज का उसके अंदर. तो हम लोग बोलेंगे कि नाउ दिस हैज अचीव्ड थर्मोडायनामिक इक्विलिब्रियम. तो एक टाइम के बाद अगर कोई चेंज नजर नहीं आ रहा है किसी भी पैरामीटर में, टेम्परेचर में भी कोई चेंज नहीं है, प्रेशर में भी कोई चेंज नहीं है, कॉन्सेंट्रेशन में भी कोई चेंज नहीं है, देन यू विल से दैट माई सिस्टम हैज अचीव्ड थर्मोडायनामिक इक्विलिब्रियम. राइट डाउन. State functions. Those properties which depend only on the initial and final states of the system are called state functions. मतलब क्या? एक सिस्टम का स्टेट ए है, वो स्टेट बी तक पहुंचा, कुछ ना कुछ चेंज हुआ उसके अंदर और फिर वो बी तक पहुंचा, और ऐसा हो सकता है कि वो ए से भी इस तरीके से पहुंचे, या हो सकता है कि वो ऐसा अलग अलग लेके पाथ फिर पहुंचे, कैसे भी पहुंच रहा है लेकिन अल्टीमेटली वो बी तक पहुंच रहा है. तो जो प्रॉपर्टीज सिर्फ और सिर्फ इनिशियल और फाइनल स्टेट्स पर डिपेंड करती हैं, दे आर कॉल्ड स्टेट फंक्शंस. मतलब क्या हुआ? मतलब ये हुआ कि वो कैसे गया उस पर कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा, घूम के गया, सीधा गया, रुक रुक के गया, उससे फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा, बट अल्टीमेटली कहा गया दैट इज द ओनली थिंग व्हिच वी हैव टू कीप इन माइंड. तो ऐसी प्रॉपर्टीज व्हिच डिपेंड ओनली ऑन द इनिशियल स्टेट एंड ऑन द फाइनल स्टेट आर कॉल्ड स्टेट फंक्शंस. दैट मींस दे डू नॉट डिपेंड ऑन द पाथ फॉलोड, दे विल डिपेंड ओनली ऑन द इनिशियल एंड फाइनल स्टेट्स. ऐसे फंक्शंस को क्या बोलते हैं, प्रॉपर्टीज को, स्टेट फंक्शंस. एग्जांपल्स क्या क्या है इसमें, एग्जांपल्स आपके इंटरनल एनर्जी, एंथैल्पी, टेम्परेचर, दिस ऑल आर कॉल्ड स्टेट फंक्शंस. सिर्फ इनिशियल पोजीशन एंड फाइनल पोजीशन सिस्टम का, बस और कुछ नहीं. दोनों को देख के वी कैन टेक अ डिसीजन. तो जो वैल्यू कैलकुलेट किया जाएगा स्टेट फंक्शन का, वो वैल्यू अल्टीमेटली सेम आएगा, चाहे आप घूम के उसको अलग अलग फॉर्म में कैलकुलेट करो या डायरेक्टली आप एक सीधा ऐसा देके कैलकुलेट करो. मतलब वो उस पे फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा कि आप कैसे आप सिचुएशन को हैंडल कर रहे हो, घूम के जा रहे हो ऐसे बी तक या सीधे रास्ते पे जा रहे हो ऐसे बी तक. इट डजंट मैटर, इट विल अल्टीमेटली गिव यू द सेम वैल्यू बिकॉज इट विल ओनली डिपेंड ऑन A, that is the initial state, and on B, which is the final state. Such properties are called state functions. तो इसका उल्टा क्या होगा, इसका उल्टा होगा पाथ फंक्शंस. सो दोस क्वांटिटीज विच विल डिपेंड ऑन द पाथ फॉलोड, यानी वो डिपेंड करेगा कि ऐसे जा रहा है कोई कि ऐसे जा रहा है कोई. ऐसे गया तो अलग वैल्यू आएगा, ऐसे गए तो अलग वैल्यू आएगा. गया ऐसे भी तक ही, इनिशियल एंड फाइनल स्टेट्स वही है, यहाँ पे भी ए से बी गया, लेकिन पाथ अलग है. अगर पाथ अलग है तो वैल्यू भी उस चीज का अलग आ जाता है, उसको बोलते हैं पाथ फंक्शंस. सो दे डिपेंड ऑन द पाथ फॉलोड बाय द सिस्टम. एग्जांपल्स आर हीट वर्क एंड हीट कैपेसिटीज. ये तीन एग्जांपल्स आपको याद रखने हैं पाथ फंक्शंस के लिए, बाकी जितने भी है सब होते हैं स्टेट फंक्शंस. तो पाथ फंक्शन आप सिर्फ ये तीन याद रखो, हीट वर्क एंड हीट कैपेसिटीज. दीज आर द थ्री पाथ फंक्शंस. Extensive properties. So these variables will depend on the size of the system or the amount of matter present in the system. मतलब क्या? अगर बड़ा size हो जाएगा system का तो वो value change हो जाएगा उस चीज का. मतलब क्या? अगर मैं बोलू moles, this mole is an extensive property. Why? Because अगर मैं ज्यादा मास लूंगा किसी सब्सटेंस का तो मोल्स भी बढ़ जाएंगे. सो मोल्स इज एन एक्सटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी. सिमिलरली अगर मैं बोलू वॉल्यूम, वॉल्यूम भी एक्सटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी होगा. क्यों? अगर कोई ज्यादा बड़ा आप सब्सटेंस रख दोगे तो वो ज्यादा स्पेस ऑक्यूपाई करेगा. छोटा सा एक पत्थर जैसा रखोगे कुछ तो वो कम स्पेस ऑक्यूपाई करेगा. तो साइज ऑफ द सिस्टम या मास ऑफ द सिस्टम पर डिपेंड कर रहा है, तो उसको क्या बोलेंगे? एक्सटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी. एग्जाम्पल से मोल्स, वॉल्यूम, वर्क, वर्क डन भी एक एक्सटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी है. हीट, हीट इज ऑल्सो एक्सटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी. So these all will depend on the number of grams or the weight or the amount of substance. लेकिन अगर मैं बोलूं टेम्परेचर, अब टेम्परेचर डज नॉट डिपेंड ऑन द मास ऑफ द सब्सटेंस. अगर मैंने बोला कि मैंने लिया है पानी, कुछ 500 ml ऑफ वाटर लिया है, उसको हीट किया है मैंने, हीट करके उसको मैं 80 डिग्री सेल्सियस तक लेके गया हूं, 80 डिग्री सेल्सियस, तो टेम्परेचर जो 80 डिग्री सेल्सियस है, दैट डज नॉट डिपेंड ऑन द क्वांटिटी ऑफ वाटर प्रेजेंट इनसाइड द बीकर. मतलब क्या हुआ? मतलब अगर मैं बोलूं कि उसी बीकर में 2 लीटर पानी लिया, पहले कितना लिया था, मानो 500 ml पहले लिया था, अभी लिया 2 लीटर, वापस मैंने इसको हीट करके 80 डिग्री सेल्सियस तक लेके जा सकता हूं, तो इस पे डिपेंड नहीं कर रहा है वो कि कितना लीटर पानी है. ऐसा तो नहीं है कि 2 लीटर हो गया तो फिर वो टेम्परेचर भी बढ़ गया, 80 से कुछ ज्यादा हो गया. यानी आधा लीटर लिया, 500 ml लिया पानी, तो भी उसका 80 डिग्री टेम्परेचर ही दिखाएगा थर्मामीटर डालूंगा तो. 2 लीटर पानी को हीट करके 80 डिग्री सेल्सियस तक लेके गया, तभी एक थर्मामीटर डालू तो भी वो 80 ही दिखाएगा. That means the temperature does not depend on the quantity of substance. So such properties are called intensive properties. So what are intensive properties? Intensive properties do not depend on the amount of matter or the size of the sample. ये सब examples से intensive properties के, temperature, density, pressure, molar volume, molar mass. किसी भी चीज के पहले अगर मोलार लग गया तो वो इंटेंसिव हो गया. कैसे? मोलार का मतलब ही होता है फॉर 1 मोल. मोलार का मतलब ही होता है इस वर्ड का कि फॉर 1 मोल. तो मोलार मास अगर मैं पूछ लूं, इट मीन्स मास ऑफ 1 मोल ऑफ द सब्सटेंस. तो जब डिफाइन ही है ऑलरेडी वो कि वो मोलार मास का मतलब ही है मास ऑफ 1 मोल, तो मैं कितना भी मोल या कितना भी ग्राम लेके आऊं, मोलार मास का वैल्यू तो वही रहेगा जो मास ऑफ 1 मोल है, कि मोलार मास का मतलब ही है मास ऑफ 1 मोल. दैट मीन्स जहां जहां वर्ड मोलार आया वहां वहां हम लोग बोल सकते हैं कि वो इंटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी है, बिकॉज द वर्ड मोलार मीन्स व्हाट? फॉर 1 मोल. सो मोलार मास, मोलार वॉल्यूम, मोलार एंथैल्पी, मोलार एंट्रोपी, जहां भी मोलार वर्ड आ गया सीधा बोल देना है कि वो इंटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी है, बिकॉज उसका डेफिनेशन में ही लिखा है कि वो 1 मोल के लिए डिफाइंड है. सिमिलरली अगर मैंने बोल दिया स्पेसिफिक, स्पेसिफिक हीट कैपेसिटी, स्पेसिफिक ग्रेविटी, ये स्पेसिफिक वर्ड का मतलब क्या हो गया? फॉर 1 ग्राम और फॉर 1 किलोग्राम. अब इसके अंदर डेफिनेशन में छुपा हुआ है कि वो 1 ग्राम के लिए डिफाइंड है या 1 किलोग्राम के लिए डिफाइंड है, तो ऑटोमेटिकली इट इज फिक्स्ड, इट विल नॉट डिपेंड ऑन द मास, बिकॉज उसका डेफिनेशन ये कहता है कि वो 1 ग्राम के लिए है. So the word specific अगर लग गया कहीं पे, सीधा हम लोग बोल सकते हैं कि वो intensive property है. तो molar लग गया तो भी intensive, specific word लग गया तो भी intensive. We will continue with the terms in the next lecture. There are some more terms.